Thank you. Me as you will. God of new beginnings, in this new season, remind us of our legacy as peacemakers. In a world full of arrogance and conceit, may we remember the importance of humility. In a world full of deception and misrepresentation, may we remember the importance of vulnerability and authenticity. And in a world full of political and ideological divisions, remind us of who we are, a community that is and has always been an example of working along differences and celebrating our diversity. May we exemplify the ideals of our community by working collaboratively towards the common good, and may we be courageous enough to be both servants and leaders to one another. As we move forward on this Inauguration Day, force us to sit in the significance of this moment. May we be present to this moment and remind us that we are all part of Centenary's legacy. Amen.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Jennifer Ward, and I am Provost and Dean of the College at Centenary. It is my great privilege to preside over the grand occasion we celebrate today. In almost 200 years of Centenary's existence, the ritual of formally recognizing a new president has only happened 31 times, including today. In addition to reminding the new president of the blessings and responsibilities that come with the call to this position of leadership, today is a time for this community to recognize its own role in aiding him in advancing this great college in service to the public good. We have representatives from near and far with us today, from north, south, east, and west, and cards and letters of greeting have come from around the country. In particular, I would like to recognize Shreveport Mayor Ollie Tyler, Emeritus Presidents of Centenary College, Drs. Don Webb, Ken Schwab, and David Rowe, Colonel Robert Kent, representing the 2nd Bomb Wing at Barksdale Air Force Base, the trustees of the college, faculty, staff, students, alumni, members of the higher education community, and friends of this college. The Honorable Ollie Tyler has been mayor of Shreveport since 2014, following a distinguished long career in education. Please welcome Mayor Tyler to the podium to give greetings from the local community.
Good afternoon. I tell you, I'm so delighted to extend warm greetings on behalf of our community, the Shreveport-Bossier community, and a special welcome is given to those of you who are from out of town. I will tell you that Mayor Walker, who is the cohort and good friend from Bossier City, was unable to be here this afternoon because of illness, but he asked me to extend his greetings on behalf of Bossier City. It is indeed an honor to be a part of this grand celebration here at Centenary College. I've had the unique pleasure of meeting and spending time with our honoree, Dr. Christopher Holoman, on a few occasions, and I'm struck by his obvious commitment to education. I'm struck by his vision, the clear vision he has for Centenary, and his desire to become deeply involved in our community. He's been here in the community for now more than 7 months, and I say without hesitation that he has been diligent in making clear assessments about boldly and positively impacting life here on the campus, as well as becoming a leader in our community. His passion for students learning inside and outside of the classroom has proven beneficial for the citizens of our community. So I say to that, forward, forward, Centenary, time and tide may fail, but our hearts shall love thee ever, Centenary hail. Dr. Holoman is the right man at the right time to lead this fine institution into the third century. Congratulations, Dr. Holoman, and may God forever bless you and Centenary.
Representing the national higher education community, Dr. Daryl D. Colson is president of Wartburg College in Iowa. Many of you may know him from an earlier position. A son of Shreveport, he was provost of Centenary College of Louisiana for a number of years, and we just learned we were graduate students at the same institution, Vanderbilt, at the same time and in the same building, Furman Hall. Please welcome Dr. Colson to the podium to bring greetings from the national higher education community.
I was asked to give a voice to the presidents and chancellors of the widely disparate array of colleges and universities that comprise this community of higher education. It's really presumptuous to think that any one person could do justice to that task, but I'm happy to give it a go. Centenary College stands in a succession of institutions of higher learning that dates all the way back to the founding of the University of Bologna in 1088. More informally, our tradition dates back further, maybe to Plato's Academy in 387 BC or so. Our role in society is paradoxical. On the one hand, we must safeguard the vast body of knowledge humankind has acquired and transmit it to future generations, a fundamentally conservative task. On the other hand, we must educate the young, inculcating within them the liberal arts, the intellectual tools that equip a free person to question tradition, to innovate, to invent. That's a profoundly radical task. Not surprisingly, we get ourselves into trouble time after time. For as we try to sail between Scylla and Charybdis, we irritate both those who think we're too conservative and those who think we're too radical. The inspirational father of the academy, Socrates, was executed for practicing the liberal arts. A mathematician who sought a position at the University of Bologna, a fellow named Galileo, concluded his life under house arrest for, again, practicing the liberal arts. It's tough to preside over an institution of higher education. Some say it's never been tougher. Well, I guess I'd say that 2009 was a tougher time, and maybe David would agree. But maybe Ken would speak up for 1991. And Ken, and Don for 1977. And who knows, maybe Plato would say that it was 387 BC. It'll always be tough. No kind of institution has a larger number of constituencies who have a legitimate stake in its welfare. From alums, trustees, donors, students, parents, staff, faculty, politicians, and neighbors, the demands are many, and their demand should be respected and addressed. For no institution is more important. Our country was founded on the conviction that we Americans, without the benefit of royalty or nobility, could govern ourselves so long as we educated our young. Generous benefactors, both church folk and others, have built Centenary College to serve that purpose. Generations of faculty and staff have devoted their professional lives to that same end. Your mission is to encourage students to become leaders in the workplace, the community, the nation, and the world at large. Chris, you've spent the first part of a career serving students in one role or another, and now you've assumed this role. All of us who serve students in this grand educational enterprise wish you every success. We're bound to you by a deep conviction that knowledge matters, that developing and exercising the liberal arts are the privilege and the obligation of every citizen, and that these young people you serve, like those we serve at our institutions, are the hope of our future, deserving the best that we can give them. As you continue walking this new path, I, along with your many other colleagues, wish you blessings.
Representing higher education in the state of Louisiana, as well as higher education associations, is Ms. Mary Ann Coleman, President of the Louisiana Association of Independent Colleges and Universities. LICU, as it's known, is a 10-member consortium of private colleges, of which Centenary is the northernmost member. Please welcome Mary Ann Coleman to the podium to give a greeting from Louisiana's higher education community and higher education associations.
Good afternoon. It is my privilege this afternoon to bring greetings to you from Louisiana Higher Education, especially the nine other private independent colleges and universities. And it is my honor as president of LAICU to participate in the inauguration of the 31st president of Centenary College. Many times, especially in this state arena, the contributions that our private colleges and universities make to the public good of Louisiana are overlooked. I have repeatedly experienced this firsthand as I have worked with legislators, governors, state agencies, and even good government groups to help them understand and appreciate the value of independent higher education. However, in all these kinds of conversations, I know I am always holding an ace, Centenary College, and Centenary College has indeed played well. For example, in 1996-97 during the formative discussion years for the TOPS program, because no legislator, the governor, commissioner of higher education, or even a public college president wanted to deny Louisiana residents the opportunity to attend Centenary College and redeem a TOPS award. All students choosing to attend an LAICU institution have been able to participate in TOPS since its inception. Centenary College has always led the way and served as a model of excellence and integrity, and I know under Dr. Holloman's leadership this will continue. And so on behalf of those faculty, staff, students in Pineville, Baton Rouge, New Orleans, and Covington, who labor in love in the service of their students, their communities, and their state, I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Holloman. Thank you.
Bringing greetings from the Louisiana Methodist Conference and Church is Bishop Cynthia Fierro Harvey. Bishop Harvey has been in her position since 2012, where she presides over 486 congregations in our state. She is well known to us at Centenary because she has also been a trustee of the college since 2012. Please welcome Bishop Cynthia Fierro Harvey to bring greetings from the Louisiana United Methodist Conference and Church.
I do bring you greetings on behalf of Louisiana United Methodists from across the entire state of Louisiana. Laity and clergy alike celebrate this day and rejoice in Dr. Holloman's leadership of Centenary College. Dr. Holloman is a man of integrity, a man of vision, and more importantly, a godly man, one who loves the church and loves the United Methodist Church. It is a great day. It is a great day for Centenary College. It's a great day for Louisiana United Methodists. And it's a great day for the entire United Methodist Church as we welcome this new leader to this great institution. Welcome, Dr. Holloman.
We will now have greetings from the Centenary College community. Representing the Board of Trustees is Mr. David Barlow. After serving several years as the chair of the Educational Quality Committee, where I was privileged to work with him closely as staff to that committee, Mr. Barlow is our recently appointed chairman of the Board of Trustees. He carries another honor as well. He's a Centenary alum. Please welcome Mr. Barlow to the podium to bring greetings from the Board of Trustees.
Thank you. So on behalf of the board, it's my great privilege and pleasure to welcome each of you here. So exciting to have so many people who care about Centenary here today, not only faculty, staff, students, alum, trustees, delegates, but also members of the Holoman family, members of the representatives of the higher education community, representatives of the United Methodist Church, presidents emeriti. Welcome to all of you. It is the Board of Trustees' job to secure and advance the mission of the college, its traditions, its values, its reputation, and perhaps no duty is more important than hiring the right president to lead the college. We are reminded of that and how we've done that in the past by the presence of our presidents emeriti here today. And in Christopher Holoman, we know that we have a president who understands, appreciates, and respects those traditions, the history of the college, the values we hold. And at the same time, we have a president who spent his first time in office here reaching out to the community, to all stakeholders, all who care about Centenary, to develop a strategic plan for the college. And that plan informs what our mission is today and what our mission means for the future, even as it's informed by the traditions of the past. So let me conclude by welcoming you all, welcoming Chris as our new president, and saying that under Chris's leadership, the Board of Trustees feels that the college and its traditions and its history are very secure, and our future is dynamic and hopeful. Thank you.
Dr. David J. Hoas is a professor of economics and recently celebrated 30 years of teaching at Centenary. He currently chairs the Faculty Coordinating Council, which is the administrative body of the faculty for a few months yet, I believe. Please welcome Dr. Hoas to the podium to give greetings from the faculty.
It is with honor today that I welcome our new president from the faculty. And in doing so, I would like to use one of his own analogies that we've heard multiple times. In fact, we just heard yesterday at the Legacy Luncheon. And the analogy is actually made famous by Sir Isaac Newton, though he wasn't the first to use it. That little story, that little piece of information tells us that if I have seen further, it's because I've stood on the shoulders of giants. We as a faculty, Dr. Holoman, want you to see far, we want you to see well. And we are ready to look with you to a bright future for Centenary College. And with a great deal of respect, as I look out over the emeriti faculty and the teaching faculty, I see giants and giants in waiting who are ready to assist you in that endeavor. Also, to steal a line from Mayor Tyler, forward, forward, President Holoman.
Celebrating her 10th year of employment at Centenary, Ms. Sage Solomon is the Director of Alumni and Family Relations and has served as chair of this year's Inauguration Committee. She's also a 2005 alumna of this fine institution. Please welcome Ms. Solomon to the podium to give greetings from the staff.
It is an incredible honor for me to represent my Centenary staff colleagues today in welcoming Dr. Holoman and his wife Connie to the Centenary family. Dr. Holoman, in the short time since you arrived on campus, I have been inspired by your passion for the liberal arts, your commitment to the members of the Centenary community, and your vision for our future. In my work with development, I have personally witnessed the willingness and enthusiasm of both you and Connie to meet the staff in the trenches in order to build and strengthen the relationships we have with all of those who love Centenary. It is a joy to work with you and serve my alma mater under your leadership. I think I speak for my colleagues when I say the future of Centenary looks bright, and I am eager to see where you will lead us in the years to come.
Mr. Patrick Cole is a 2006 alumnus of the college and is an attorney here in Shreveport. He also serves as the current Alumni Association president. Please welcome Mr. Cole to the podium to bring greetings from the alumni community.
Thank you all, and on behalf of the Alumni Association, we'd like to extend our warmest welcome to Dr. Holloman, his wife Connie, and their family as we welcome them into our community. Whenever I think of my time at Centenary, which admittedly wasn't that long ago, I'm often struck by the emphasis that was placed on faith, family, friendship, and community. And I think that those things have certainly been on display this week. And in the short time we've come to know Dr. Holloman, it's very evident that he and Connie also place equally as important an emphasis on those things, which I think is why he's already proven himself to be such a wonderful fit within our community. So on behalf of the Alumni Association, we'd like to congratulate Dr. Holloman on his inauguration as becoming the 31st president of Centenary College, and we greatly look forward to watch the ways in which the college will grow under his leadership. So congratulations, Dr. Holloman.
Mr. Ben Green is the current president of the Student Government Association. He's a senior graduating at the end of April and also carries the honor of having been a finalist for the Rhodes Scholarship this year. Please welcome Mr. Green to the podium to give greetings from the student body, well represented.
On behalf of all Centenary students, I'd like to formally welcome Dr. Holloman to our tight-knit community, a community of engaged scholars and leaders. In just a few months, Dr. Holloman has already made it obvious that he truly values student opinion. He's consistently relied on the Student Government Association to gauge student perspective. He's hosted monthly dinner meetings with the Maroon Jackets. He supported our ladies and gents athletic teams. Though some people might consider students to be merely rotating customers, Dr. Holloman has shown us that he still believes students deserve a seat at the table. And as a student, that's all I could ever ask for from our college president. My hopes for the future of Centenary are ones in which students, now and after graduation, continue to love and support this institution through the inevitable and necessary changes that will take place. I'm confident that both students and Dr. Holloman will continue in this already established relationship of mutual trust and support, both coming to the decision table with open ears and open minds. To community members, friends of the college, alumni, faculty, staff, and administrators, I speak for all students when I tell you how excited we are about Centenary's future with Dr. Holloman at the helm. Forward, forward, Centenary, and welcome, President Holloman.
We are delighted to welcome many members of President Holloman's family here today who've traveled from Texas, Georgia, North Carolina, Ohio, and California to celebrate this occasion. Bringing greetings from the family are the President's daughters, Allie and Fran. Allie is a Phi Beta Kappa graduate of the University of North Carolina and holds a master's degree in education from American University in Washington, D.C. Allie and her husband, Jamie, live in Columbus, Ohio, and are the parents of seven-month-old Milo Christopher Fritz, who is almost exactly the same age as his granddad's presidency. Fran earned her bachelor's degree in psychology at Oberlin College, where she competed on the women's basketball and track teams, and is completing her master's degree in school psychology from Winthrop University. Fran and her fiancé, Kate, are planning an October wedding in North Carolina. Please welcome Ms. Fritz and Ms. Holloman to the podium to bring greetings from the family.
Good afternoon. I'm Allie. This is Fran. We're so pleased to be here with you today. We'd like to thank Centenary College, the city of Shreveport, Bossier City. You've all been so welcoming to my parents, and Fran and I are so glad to get to know you all as well.
We also want to take a minute and thank our family for being able to be here with us. You've traveled from far and wide to join us. We are fortunate to have all three of my dad's brothers and their better halves with them, as well as my cousin from Atlanta. And we are so grateful to have the opportunity to join in the Centenary family together as a family. We also want to take a minute and remember those family members who are not able to be with us here today, whether because of geography or because their time here on Earth has been up. We want to particularly remember our grandparents, Ray, Francis, Kern, and Kay, who all would be incredibly proud of all that my dad has accomplished in his life.
We'd like to tell you a quick story about Dr. Holoman, or as we call him, Dad. When Fran and I were children, we used to watch Jeopardy growing up with our parents, and we would say, "Daddy, how do you know all the answers?" And he would tell us, as his father used to say to him, "Every question's easy when you know the answer." And we're pleased to report that our dad knows all the answers and all the questions. But it's not just Jeopardy or trivia. It's a deep passion for knowledge and for the liberal arts, as many of our other speakers have commented on. And we're so proud to have carried on the tradition of a love of education. And we're glad to share our dad and his wisdom with you and this community. Thank you. Thank you.
Oh,
It is now my honor to introduce Dr. Donald Webb, who served as the 28th president of Centenary College from 1977 to 1991. Dr. Webb, a Welsh native, served in the Royal Navy and is an ordained minister in the United Methodist Church. Please welcome Dr. Webb to the podium to offer reflections on the presidency and to introduce Dr. Holoman.
Grace and peace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. It is indeed an honor to introduce Dr. Holoman, but he did ask me, rather than do that by, say, illuminating his bio, which we've all read and are thrilled by, that I do reflect on presidency. He assumes I know what serves well here, in that I was installed here 40 years ago this month, and as number 28. If I do know what works well here, it's because ever since I have studied the strengths of the other 29. Present company, gratefully included. So to start with, it helps to be very tall. But that's a given. What are not given are the other essential qualities. They have to be learned the hard way, preferably before coming. I didn't know that. The vital skills, for example. Dr. Labor called the president a funambulist. That means tightrope walker. You know how English professors are. Imagine up on a high wire over campus, a balancing figure, blown upon from all sides by the needs of faculty, trustees, the church, the alumni, the students, male, female, athletes, the conglomerate. Is there still a conglomerate? I used to pray for the conglomerate. Hamilton Hall is no place for an acrophobic. President Rowe, spotted in my ill-spent youth a training that would surely help a president. I wish I'd remembered this, minesweeping in World War II. Those totally unexpected, astonishingly frequent and heart-wrenching campus explosions that mean Hamilton Hall is no place for an extricophobic. Where are you, Dr. Labor? It is a place, since the president is top administrator, for top-notch, oiled, efficient administration. And since we're a college, it's best if he's been a college prof and understands our unique profession. Since we're a private college, we'll always be short of funds, so it's best if he's a wizard fundraiser. And since even so, we'll still be short of funds, it's best if be a budget wrestler and victor. On campus, he must be both firm, fair enforcer of alma mater's codes, yet fierce defender of her freedoms, and off campus, her winsome ambassador, always enhancing her image. And while he's out there, raising a little more money, et cetera, et cetera. You, and I'm sure the wise trustees can think of a score more, but time presses. Vital skills, then. Second is effort. This job takes hard work. It is a joy, but it demands firing on all eight cylinders, 24/7, 365. Dr. Holoman, I'm not sure how many ulcers this job might inflict were it not that we have a gift from God, you and I. Beloved winds beneath our wings. Mine called Renee, yours Connie. And that's what makes it all possible. And of course we are Methodists, that helps, because in our theology is that Protestant work ethic convincing us to use, for God's sake, every ounce of energy and drive he gives us. And we're Americans, of the stock that made wildernesses into this bountiful nation. Our faith and our heritage enable us to work flat out, and that's what it takes, effort. There's a third, respect. Long ago, there was automatic reverence for authority. Hitler, Stalin, and a couple of others cured us of that. Respect has to be earned. When we see a president using those vital skills flat out, but with integrity, with compassion, with courage, and with always a mutual respect for colleagues and staff and students, we will follow. The fourth asset is vision. It's a mark of fine leaders that swifter and surer than others, they discern the real purpose of the group's being and facilitate the way to achieve it. You'll see this soon in the master plan. And I've no wish or ability to influence it, but I've always loved Jesus' misquote of Deuteronomy 6:4. Remember Mark 12, two great commandments are to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. But Deuteronomy 6:4 doesn't mention your mind. Jesus added it and lifted us to a whole new height and reach. Now to really live means using everything we've got, our brains included, in love of God and our neighbor. Sets us to seek, find, and teach the truths that make us and the neighbor free. So may this place be where all have all it's in them to be, radiantly enabled. And that's the fifth key to presidency, enablement. The whole point is enablement of students, of course, sine qua non, but the colleagues too, enable them to be all they can. I've overrun, sorry, but you may have noticed that to help my nonagenarian gray cells remember what I hope to say, I put these presidential qualities in a mnemonic: skills, effort, vision, respect, enablement. No. Skills, effort, respect, vision, enablement. S-E-R-V-E. That's the heart of it. Serve. George Thomas, Speaker of Britain's House of Commons, on this spot, roughly, when he spoke here, said his motto is bid ben, bid bont. It's Welsh, not surprising for a Welshman. To be a leader, one must be a bridge. People walk on a bridge. He didn't mind sometimes being walked on when it helps move forward, unified guidance for the good of the whole. That's the heart of it. And Dr. Holoman, I believe that in describing this good servant leader, I have introduced you with all my heart. I'm sure I speak for everyone here. I wish God's richest blessings on you, on your future here, may it be long, and on the life of our beloved college under your command.
The official investiture of Dr. Christopher L. Holloman as the 31st president of Centenary College of Louisiana will be presided over by Mr. David Barlow, Chairman of the Board. Mr. Barlow, would you please approach the podium? Dr. Holloman, would you please come forward to center stage? And Emeritus Presidents Webb, Schwab, and Rowe, would you please join Dr. Holloman?
By virtue of the authority of the Centenary College of Louisiana Board of Trustees, we commit to you the charter of the college, symbolizing the historic legacy of the school, which is entrusted to you. Dr. Webb, Dr. Schwab, and Dr. Rowe, please present Dr. Holloman with the charter of Centenary College. Will the faculty marshals please join Dr. Holloman? Dr. Holloman, we now present you with the Centenary Mace to symbolize the authority of leading and protecting the faculty. George Nelson, will you please join Dr. Holloman? And we place, Dr. Holloman, over your shoulders the seal of the college, the symbol of the high office which you now hold. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to now present to you the 31st President of Centenary College, Dr. Christopher L. Holloman.
Thank you so much. Thank you for all those warm greetings. Much of what I'm going to say has already been said, but if you think that's going to keep me from saying it again, you're sadly mistaken. I could spend all of my allotted time thanking everyone who has made Connie and me feel so welcome in these months. The faculty, the staff, the students, way to go students, the Board of Trustees, the community. But I want to lift up three groups in particular for special thanks. My predecessors as president of Centenary College, including John Allen, who Dr. Webb's predecessor, who gave some thought to coming and decided it was just a little bit too much of a trip. Some people say the United States Senate is the most exclusive club in the world. They've got 100 people. I'm in a club of five. So I think that's pretty cool. I want to thank the Inauguration Committee, especially the Chair, Sage Solomon, and Connie Whittington, but all the committee worked so hard. It was really, my wife Connie kept saying, we need a bigger committee. That committee's too small. And I said, they got it. And they worked really, really hard. And this has been a glorious day, and I am deeply appreciative. And finally, I do want to thank the members of my family who have come. It really is special. All of my family are really interesting people in their own right. Kern and Betty and Dick and Carolyn and David and Debbie. You saw my daughters. My nephew, Jeff. I do want to tell you, Jeff is here representing Auburn. And mindful of where we are geographically, I'm reluctant to tell you, but he was Aubie the Tiger for 4 years. So you can talk with him. So thank you very much. It's a great day. Over the last 8 months, actually tomorrow is my 8-month anniversary, Many of you have heard me talk in some context or another about calling. Frequently the context was my own calling and how I ended up at Centenary. But today I want to talk about our calling together as Centenary College in this time and place, and how we will live out that calling in our strategic plan. First, let me reiterate that this is our calling together. I'm certain that, like me, most of our terrific faculty and staff feel a special calling into their individual positions. Lord knows they're not in it for the money. Am I right? But it is especially important to discern our collective calling. Many of you are familiar with the book Good to Great by Jim Collins and his metaphor of the bus, and that it's so important to have the right people in the right seats on the bus. I heard a speaker about a month ago, and he challenged that metaphor because he pointed out that the only person working on the bus is the driver. Everybody else is sitting in the back playing games on their phone. And he suggested that the more appropriate metaphor was the rowing shell. And as I pushed on that metaphor in my mind, I realized that not only was he right, but he didn't go far enough, because not only does everybody need to be rowing, they need to be rowing in the same time, in the same direction. Otherwise, the shell veers off course, wanders back and forth, and worst case scenario, runs into the bank. Our common calling, as set forth in our mission statement and operationalized in our new strategic plan, will assure that we are all rowing in the same direction and with the same rhythm. And one of the imperatives, or what we are now calling the pillars of the plan, is that Centenary will commit to providing our faculty and staff with the resources, the infrastructure, and the culture to carry out our calling together. So we're called. Called to what? I entitled this talk, Called to This Time and Place, but I suppose that needs a little bit of fleshing out. Called to this time. Centenary College must continue to do what we have done for almost 200 years, prepare our students with the tools to live both a fulfilled life as individuals and to be valued in the marketplace. We must continue to articulate passionately our belief in the value of a liberal arts education, and to reject the narrative that that education is somehow disconnected from the needs of our society and our community. We are told, depending on which visionary you listen to, that the world is disrupted, turbulent, connected, flat. However you choose to characterize it, we live in a world that above all else is defined by change. Our students will have to negotiate that change. Many of you have heard me quote the statistic, something like a third of our freshmen this year, when they get out of college, will take a job that doesn't exist today. Fortunately, the skills we prepare them with are exactly what the market is calling for. Communication, critical thinking, teamwork, and perhaps all above all, creativity. One of the few things that seems reliably predictable about the future is that anything that can be automated will be. I heard an anecdote a few months ago, and my friend Rick Bateman from BPSI, the Chancellor of BPSI, who I'm honored to say is here today, recently told me that the exact source is Tom Friedman. And he says that the factory of the future will consist of a machine, a man, and a dog. The man is there to feed the dog. The dog is there to make sure the man doesn't touch the machine. As it has been since the Industrial Revolution, tasks that involve essentially repetition without creativity will be done by machines. It's just that the machines have gotten so much better. In the end, though, we still need people that have the creativity and agility of mind to solve the problems in the first place. Some of you may have seen Mark Cuban's comments to Business Insider a couple of weeks ago. Now, I know we have some Texans here, including my brother Dick. I can't comment on Cuban's prowess as an NBA team owner, but I know he's got a good track record as a businessman and forward thinker. He said, quoting, "I personally think there's going to be a greater demand in 10 years for liberal arts majors than there were for programming majors and maybe even engineering. Because when the data is all being spit out for you, options are being spit out for you, you need a different perspective in order to have a different view of the data. And so having someone who is more of a freer thinker we won't talk about his grammar, but who is having someone who is more of a freer thinker, a freer thinker. That's precisely the original meaning of the word liberal in liberal arts. One of my colleagues says we need to be teaching our students, helping our students learn uniquely human skills. I think that's a wonderful phrase. In our strategic plan, we address both the curricular and co-curricular experience. We know that as much student learning takes place outside the classroom as inside the classroom. So we'll emphasize the need for a coherent experience that allows students to make meaning from all aspects of their time here. We will continue to emphasize the need for our students to be exposed to the global community they will work in, building on the programs that have made Centenary the college with the highest percentage of students that have an international educational experience. That's something to be extremely proud of, and we will continue to shout that from the rafters. We are also called to this time to answer not just the needs of the marketplace, but the needs of our society. The oldest tradition of the academy, as David Barlow pointed out, the oldest tradition of the academy is the pursuit of truth through dialogue. We are all descendants of Socrates, who taught through questioning, through asking his students to examine their ideas, pushing at the weak spots, revealing the critical core. Iron sharpens iron, the Bible tells us. Disagreements are not inherently wrong. We seem to have turned away from the idea behind the phrase, reasonable people can disagree. Today, if you don't agree with me, you must be evil, stupid, or disloyal. As educators, we must stem this tide. For the sake of our society, our nation, and our world, we must model and support the ability to reason through our differences. And to be able to acknowledge our own fallibility. Oliver Cromwell said, I beseech you by the bowels of Christ to think it possible you may be mistaken. We must be able to change our minds as we engage with others of different minds in the pursuit of truth. We're also called to this place, called to this time, called to this place. And I mean that at a number of levels. At the most local, Centenary needs to be actively engaged as an anchor for the Highlands neighborhood. We want to be partners with other institutions, agencies, and individuals to bring about a safe and dynamic community. We'll continue to make our campus spaces available and welcoming for our neighbors. Moving outward, one of the pillars of our strategic plan from the very beginning has been to enhance Centenary's position as Shreveport-Bossier's college. We've been here for 109 years, 110 years next year, obviously, math major. As a private, residential, liberal arts college, we play a unique role in this community. It is a role that is valued by many of the leaders in our community who have benefited from exactly this kind of education, whether here or at our sister institutions around the region and the country, some of whom I am so honored to say are represented here today. While Centenary is small, our economic and cultural impact is significant, and the presence of a great liberal arts college in the community is an important factor in businesses and individuals' decisions to locate here. We will be a part of the revival of our city and area being so ably led by Mayor Tyler. As we plan and develop new academic programs, we will have the needs of our community as a top criterion in making those decisions. Building out from the success of the Center for Family-Owned Business, we will be working to help our Shreveport-Bossier workforce address their requirements for continuing education and other types of non-degree education. We need to work with our higher education partners in this area. I am accustomed to working in a strong consortium of colleges and universities. I truly believe that we are not competitors. We each have our own institutional charges, our own strengths that we bring to the table. At Centenary, we look forward to working with our other great institutions in the area to help our students have clear pathways to success. The student experience today is sometimes referred to as swirl, as students move back and forth between colleges, back and forth, and sometimes back again. We will work with our friends in this area and in the state and in the region to give those students clear paths to success. One of the goals we've identified is to build on our strength as a cultural center for the Arklatex region. From the firm foundations of the Meadows Museum and the Marjorie Lyons Playhouse, from our music program, including the World Traveling Centenary Choir, we can go farther. Our provost, Dr. Jennifer Ward, thank you, Jennifer, has insightfully identified that we sit at a unique cultural crossroads. We can draw on the Cajun and Creole heritage of southern Louisiana, the cowboy culture of Texas, the Ozark legacy to our north, and the Mississippi River traditions to our east. This rich tapestry, I think, offers untapped potential to both showcase and study the way these cultures live and interact, how we tell stories, and how we can preserve our roots. Finally, we are called to both this time and place by our heritage and history with the United Methodist Church. I am honored that so many clergy accepted my invitation to join the academic procession. Centenary is proud of its many graduates who are serving churches in both ordained and lay roles, and we will be building and strengthening the Christian Leadership Center, as well as our ties to the conferences, both in Louisiana and Texas, the local churches, and the Perkins School of Theology. There are also some exciting new opportunities being developed among the consortium of United Methodist Colleges and Universities, and we'll be hearing more about those in the months and years to come. As we do all of these things and others, including strengthening our athletics program where we sit, we will accomplish our most immediate need to grow enrollment. Centenary will always and proudly be a small school, but it is no secret that we are currently too small. I am confident that we are putting in place strategies and plans that will bring us more students while not compromising our academic standards or diminishing the quality of our student experience. As many of you know, although I'm a lifelong United Methodist, I spent the last 16 years working at a Franciscan college, one of the reasons we sang the hymn we did, referencing back to St. Francis. He's a fascinating man. He's much more complex than the little figure sitting on the birdbath. And he shares a lot, actually, with John Wesley, but that's a topic for another day. In his final moments, as he waited to join who he called Sister Death, he turned to his followers at his bedside and said, "I have done what is mine to do. May Christ show you what is yours." As a community, we have spent the last several months discerning what is ours to do. And now it is time to move to action. Some of you maybe have heard me quote Dr. Martin Luther King. It's one of my favorites. He said, "We are now faced with the fact, my friends, that tomorrow is today. We are confronted with the fierce urgency of now. In this unfolding conundrum of life and history, there is such a thing as being too late. Procrastination is still the thief of time. The tide in the affairs of men does not remain at flood, it ebbs. We may cry out desperately for time to pause in her passage, but time is adamant to every plea and rushes on. So must we. I truly believe we have a bright future together as a college and a community. I am humbled to be entrusted with the legacy of this great college and excited to lead it toward its third century. So indeed, forward, forward, Centenary." Thank you. Please stay standing and join me in the alma mater. The choir will then sing the benediction. Please remain seated for the academic procession and then join us in the quad for a reception. Thank you so much for coming. I'm truly touched. Thank you.
Gleams of light.